Zion Church, how's everyone doing tonight? Tight. How's everyone doing tonight? Cold. Welcome to church tonight. We have something super special for you guys tonight. We actually have the cutest Sunday of the year prepared for you. So our very own Zion kids will be joining us for worship. How many believe that there's no junior Holy Spirit? That the same Holy Spirit that's inside of us is inside of our children. So I believe and I'm expectant that just them singing isn't going to be cute, but I believe that you're going to feel the Lord on this tonight. Okay? Is that okay? Cool. So we're going to give our kids a little bit of a moment here to get situated, and we're going to get started.
Thank you. come for him, purple pine gum. I played my best for him, purple pine gum. Rubber pom pom, rubber pom pom. Then he smiled at me, rubber pom pom. Me and my drum, me and my drum. I say, me and my drum, me and my drum. All right, parents, sing along. Come, me and my drum, me and my drum, me and my drum, me and my drum, me and my
In the beginning was a dream. The dream was God's hope, and God was hope. Spoke his imaginations to a world that only knew void and translated it to everything that is here now. That hope has come again. In the midst of despair and nightmares, God's dream for our lives has finally come true. His hope. It turns a trough into a throne. As creator steps into creation and the ruler becomes a servant. It's hope that makes a map out of stars and leads wise men to the place where God is doing the miraculous. It's hope that declares that distance has become near, for the Lord's promise is finally here at last, Emmanuel. With man, he dwells in and among us, just as God had always dreamed it would be since the beginning. In the beginning, when he chose to love us even after we chose another, he promised that a chosen one would come and choose to take on flesh, choose to take on death and lay down his life to pay the price for all of our poor choices. Like where we place our hopes. Mine are often more Christmas than they are Advent, more focused on stuff or things than it is nativity. We place our longings on lifeless objects and hope that wrapping them in our affection will somehow turn them to gifts. We've gotten too good at decorating dead trees, but our God has sown the seed in the hopes that we might be rooted in his dream for our lives. It's hope that turns shepherds into watchmen, that those who have gone unnoticed be the first to bear witness to the good news. It's hope that turns doubters into dreamers, but just as God's spirit had moved in Mary's womb and in the canvas of Joseph's mind, our God has coated many colors on his paintbrush to paint his imagination on the backs of our eyelids. See now. That hope has come again, that God's dream has once more invaded our sleeping world to transform our unexpected hearts through the miracle of an expecting virgin. How else can we hope for tomorrow unless a son be given to us, and he has? Hope has come and hope is yet coming, and we prepare to receive the coming of what we truly need, and we prepare to receive this dream and the hope that it brings, and we prepare to receive the coming of our King, the coming of our hope.
The poor baby waits, the little Lord.
Kids, we're gonna pour it out to Jesus tonight, all right? Here we go. Parents, you can sing along too. Say, we love you, Jesus. You ready? 1, 2, 3. All right. We're going to ask all our parents to stand to our feet, and we're going to sing this last song together. You guys ready, kids?
Joy to the world, the Lord is come.
Shake those bells.
Let earth receive the King. Let every heart prepare in room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and
Yeah. Get your photos now. They'll be available for autographs at the end. Great job, kids.
Go ahead and take a seat. Wow, that's a tough act to follow. Thanks for being here tonight. My name's Eric. This is my wife, Cammie. We get to do announcements, which is not nearly as cute and cuddly as that. If this is your first time here with us, welcome. If you've been here before, welcome. We want to get to know all of you. And the best way to do that, if you haven't already, is to go to the Connections booth and meet with one of our team members over there, one of the hospitality team members. Also, if you want to serve, or if you want to be baptized, or you just want to get plugged in with a life group of some sort, do me a favor, go on to zionchurch.online, scroll down to the bottom, and you'll see a connect little section. And there you'll be able to put in your name and email and all of that. And if you have any questions or anything, there's a spot for that. But that allows us to connect with you. And most importantly, with church being mobile, it's super important for us just to kind of get the word out of where church is going to be every Sunday and at what time. You guys have been so awesome to kind of switch parking lots, look at the weather, and pay attention on Instagram. But we also want to email you about that, too. Along those lines, starting January 3rd, the first January of the year, we are moving to mornings, 10 a.m., so, yes, thank you for some of you morning people. That's me. I'm excited. The other announcement is if you're on a team, a serve team, or if you just want to serve and get a be plugged into a serve team, we do have a serve team night this Wednesday at 6:30 at sanclemente Christian School. There you'll be able to, if you haven't already been plugged into a team, we can get you plugged into the right team that needs help, needs you. And there's one more. Oh, this is a big one. Christmas service night is December 20th. It is here, and it starts at 4 o'clock. So 4 o'clock, you can come. We have photo booths. We have cotton candy. We have coffee. Bring a friend. Bring your family.
We have donuts.
And donuts. There's donuts. And then church, again, will start at 5 o'clock. But come early and come hang out with us.
Okay, so every time we get asked to do this and we have to do the giving block, every time, it's like been two times. every time we do this, I always am like, okay, how can I like inspire people to give when they don't want to? And I realize that's on me. That's like where my heart's at a lot of times with giving. I think I'm a reluctant giver sometimes. So I just wanted to share a conversation Eric and I have been having in recent weeks when John gave a message on generosity. And we were just talking about what it means to be actually generous people and if we consider ourselves generous people and what that looks like. So back in March, when the pandemic hit, do you guys remember when you thought it was going to be 2 weeks and then it was going to be over? You do. So after like 3 weeks, we kind of started figuring out like, okay, this isn't going away. Like Eric's still at home working with me. And we're like, okay, what are we going to do? The world felt really uncertain. And my sweet, sweet little landlord lady, she's like 86 years old. She called me to see how I'm doing, even though she's like the at-risk community. And she was like, you know what? We know how it feels to like be in these uncertain times. Like, you guys just take a month off. You don't need to pay rent this month. And I like lost it. Like, that was such a gift to us. Like, to have extra to just meet ends meet and to not be worried about that was like such a gift. Well, here we are. What is it, like nine, 10 months in to the pandemic, and I feel like I started to think like, oh, that money's mine. Like, I started to like take that generosity and just kind of come away with like entitlement almost. Like, okay, like that was really nice, but I've spent that money. I have places I can put that money, you know? And I was thinking about this today and just about like being generous, and we were put in a position where we were asked to give above our normal giving. And it's a super awesome opportunity. And my initial reaction is like, well, I don't know if we have extra. Like, I don't know about this. And like, here I am, like thinking back to like 6 months ago when that generosity was given to me, and like, what a cool thing. And then I'm presented with an opportunity and I'm like, I don't know, gotta keep it, gotta hold tight. So anyway, all that to say, I wanna say that I'm not like preaching, I don't know where this is coming from, but I just wanted to say that I think reluctant giving comes from two places. I think one is just forgetting what God has given you and that it's not ours to begin with. And I think the other part is just, mistrust in his provision and that he's got your back. So I needed to hear that tonight. I don't know if anybody else did, so sorry for rambling. But I'm just going to read this verse that really reminds me that God's got my back and that giving is a joyful thing and that it's a good thing and that we're called to it and it's freeing. So I'm going to read from Psalms 23, and it says, "The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He takes me to lush pastures. He leads me to refreshing water. He restores," I don't know why I'm getting emotional. "He restores my strength. He leads me down the right paths for the sake of his reputation. Even when I must walk through the darkest valley, I fear no danger, for you are with me." So all that to say, God's got your back. And when he asks you to give, you can give knowing that he's going to take care of you and that his provision is there. So there's three ways that you can give at Zion Church. And give, if this is your home church, this is where you're called to give. There's a lot of opportunities to give, and we're called to pulled in a lot of different directions. But here at Zion, there are three ways that you can give. There's a giving box in the back. I believe it's at the connection booth. You can text Zion and any amount to the number 84321, or you can go to zionchurch.online/give and give there. I'm just going to pray.
Sam's, do you want to say something about
that? Oh, yeah. If you want to know where your giving's going, there's lots of cool things that Zion is doing with that money. We supported and adopted 12 families from in partnership with FAM Ministries. I actually don't know the full name of FAM. Family Assisted Ministries. Which has just been such a cool opportunity, and you guys did that. Your generosity did that, and that's a really cool thing. So if you want to continue to pour out in that way, I just told you the ways you can do that. So I'm just going to pray for us. Heavenly Father, I praise you, and I thank you for giving us these opportunities to be able to give, Lord. Please remind me of the generosity that you've given me, Lord. Let me believe it, that you are my provider. Lord, I pray that you would inspire us tonight through John's word. I pray that we'd be able to receive it, and I pray that we would walk away today changed. And I thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do tonight, because we are so expectant. And I give all this to you, Lord, in your name. Amen.
Hey, can we give it up for Cammy and Eric? You know, I do just want to say something, and they hate attention, which is why I'm going to do it. But Eric and Cammy, I just felt like as you shared that, like God was just saying that he's pleased with you guys. He has seen the things that maybe even in your your quiet time at home, maybe areas of sacrifice and pain that you've gone through that no one else knows about. And he's seen your heart. He's seen your sacrifice. He's seen your generosity and joy and resiliency in the midst of a really tough season. And he's pleased with you. He loves you so much. He is your father. And I just bless you guys right now with his grace, with his mercy and his favor. I just feel like 2021 is going to be a year of breakthrough for you guys personally. And God's going to show up in incredible ways. And you're going to look back even on this Sunday and say, wow, God, you're so good. And so I bless you guys in the grace of Jesus Christ. Amen. So, and you never have to apologize for getting emotional on stage, because this guy does it every Sunday. And hey, can we honor our Zion kids for such an amazing kids performance? It's so cool, because I'm preaching about joy this evening. And at times in 2020, it's been hard to remember what joy feels like, right? And I felt like it was such a pure and beautiful reminder as these kids were up here singing with joy and praising Jesus and reminding us about what this season is about, to remind us that good news is to be found, to remind us that joy is to be experienced, to be reminded that above the fray of the fear of the media, there is hope to be found. This is a beautiful season, a life-giving season. And man, I just want to give it up for my boy Elijah with that spoken word. What? He should be preaching up here tonight. Man, you've got an anointing on your life. And like, I truly mean that. Like, it's not just a performance, man. There is something unique and special about you. And if you can hear me, Elijah, man, I love you. And I just see something so special where God's going to use your ability to think very intentionally about things. And oh my gosh, being able to remember that, I would never be able to remember that. And your articulation and your creativity and your innovation, God's going to use it in beautiful and powerful ways. And so, man, I just bless you, brother. I love it. I'm so excited about the word that God's put on my heart. We're in our second part, our second installment in the collection of talks that we've titled For All People, our Christmas series. Last week we talked about how in the midst of a season of bad news, unfortunate news, challenging news, it's so important to remember that we have good news. That God is with us, that God is for us. Christmas reminds us that there is good news to be found. And tonight I want to talk about this idea of joy. Because it says in Luke chapter 2, verse 8, that night there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep, and suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified. This was the natural response when God's glory shows up. But the angel reassured them, do not be afraid. And I just want to say right at the start, whatever you're going through, whatever you came into this gathering with, whatever has transpired in 2020, God is telling you right now, as we're about to launch into a brand new year, do not be afraid. Why? He said, I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. And what we're going to talk about this evening is this idea that Jesus alone truly is the only source of great joy, lasting joy. Real joy, not temporary happiness, not just an emotional surge of joy, but consistent, perpetual joy that flows from the inside out. I want to ask you guys a question. What brings you joy? Like, what truly brings you joy in life? I read an article recently about it, and it listed a couple things that can bring you joy. And this is the real response. These are the things that can bring you joy. coffee, amen. Wine and chocolate, that was in the same list. Hopefully not all together at the same time. Coffee, wine, and chocolate, someone said. Someone said, finding the perfect pair of jeans is what brings you great joy. Someone said, shopping, retail therapy is what brings you great joy. Another person said, almond butter, avocado, and oat milk. This person was from Orange County, for sure. Absolutely. This was my favorite one. What could bring you joy in 2020? Someone said, getting a houseplant. Getting a houseplant? Like, is that literally what we've become? Like, we're so depressed, we need to get more houseplants. Like, I'm all about, foliage. I mean, I'm a big foliage guy. But, like, houseplants to produce great joy in our lives? Like, is that what it's come to? And I want to talk about true joy. Not just a temporary jolt of happiness, but the kind of joy that God wants to give you, this resounding, consistent, vibrant, overflowing sense of satisfaction that no matter what's going on around you, everything is going to be all right. It seems as if this thing called joy is truly elusive, isn't it? Like, how is it that at times it can seem like everything is working out in your life and yet you're still not happy? And you wonder, like, why am I not stoked? I checked everything off the list. I got everything that my heart dreamed of. I got the job. I married that spouse. I got that car. I got that house. And why am I still unsatisfied? Why am I still depressed? Why am I still anxious and stressed out of my mind? Do you guys know that just because you're a Christian, it doesn't mean that you're automatically living with true joy? You can be a Christian and still be mean. You can be right and still be mean. You can be saved and still be stressed. Joy can feel so elusive at times, and it's not the accumulation of more things in your life that gives you joy. It's kind of a sneaky thing. And then oftentimes we'll compare our life with other people's lives and we'll say, man, it seems like they're experiencing so much joy, and I would be able to experience that same level of joy if I had that, or if I got there, or if I looked that way. I would have joy if, and you can fill in the blank in your life. And I want to ask you guys this evening, as you walked into this gathering, do you truly have joy in the journey of life? Can you honestly say that you wake up and you're so glad that you're fully alive in Jesus Christ? You live with a heart of gratitude, thankfulness, peace. There's a rest to your pace. There's an expectancy to your faith. There's a passion in your relationship with Jesus Christ. There is a joy in your journey. Because I truly believe that the Holy Spirit tonight, if you don't have it, wants to add an unparalleled joy in your journey. That's why the title of this message this evening, if you're taking notes, is Great Joy. A joy that can only come from Jesus. And I want to give you guys four reasons why I can live with joy because of Jesus. Number one, the reason why I can live with joy because of Jesus, and this is the most important thing. This actually is a thing that leads everything else. Everything else flows from this. Number one, because my sins are forgiven. Are you grateful that your sins are forgiven? Are you thankful that Jesus came and lived a perfect life and died for you? I love how it says in the passage that we read earlier, I'm going to bring you good news. And this good news is going to do what? It's going to bring you an experience of great joy. And who's it for? It's for all people. It's for rich people, for poor people, for black people, for white people. This is for every person, the whosoever's. Why? Because the Savior of the world has come. The Savior is here. And I want to tell you why that's such good news. Because the truth is that most of us that are here tonight have some things in our life that we're ashamed of. Memories that we regret. experiences that we try to forget. Some of us here are filled with so much guilt, shame, and regret that we've been caught in cycles where we go back to it and back to it, and we rewind and we replay those memories and those moments of trauma, those tragedies, those things in our story that we hate about ourselves or we hate that happened to us, and we are filled with guilt, shame, and regret, and we don't know if we're forgiven by God. And for some of us, we know that God has forgiven us, but we haven't forgiven ourselves. And for many of us, we try to do everything that we can do to distance ourselves from the pain of the shame and the guilt and the regret, that we go to coping mechanisms. We go to pain management ways to escape that memory, escape that pain, to distance ourselves from the emotional trauma that we would rather not experience. But at the end of the day, when it all comes down to it, nothing washes away the past. And in the end, that's what we all need. Something to completely wipe away our sin. And that's why it's so powerful to remember that when John the Baptist was on the scene, as the New Testament begins in the Gospels, and he sees Jesus for the first time, John the Baptist is at the Jordan River baptizing people. He sees Jesus, he looks up, and it's so important to know the importance of this declaration in John chapter 1, verse 29. He sees Jesus and he says, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And at first glance, that verse may not have a ton of impact. And maybe you've heard that verse before, but it's so important to realize the gravity of that. Because in order to move forward in life with joy as your normative experience, it requires some looking back. The first humans, Adam and Eve, they're in a perfect experience with God and perfect relationship with Him. They're strolling with God in the garden. It says that God would walk with Adam and Eve in the cool of the day. They would hang out and they would talk. But then there was that moment where sin entered the world and they decided to go their own way. And in that moment, brokenness came into the relationship between humanity and a perfect God. And it broke God's heart. And it damaged our hearts. Because their very first reaction wasn't to run to God and say, "Hey, I sinned, God." Their very first reaction after they sinned was to do what? To hide. What we still do today. And they hid and they realized their nakedness and their shame. And in that moment, it was the first time that blood was shed. God sacrificed an animal and he took the hide of that animal and he made covering. He made clothing for Adam and Eve to hide their sense of nakedness and shame and guilt. He covered them in that moment. But the reality was is that clothing wore out, and so Adam and Eve, they had to remake their own coverings over and over again. Fast forward through history, Moses descends from Mount Sinai with the law that God had given him, the Ten Commandments. And the Israelites discovered that God included a provision for sin. So when Israelites sinned, it was a requirement to sacrifice an animal, and the animal's blood covered the consequence of that sin. It was a bloody and poignant reminder that your sin and my sin pains God's heart and has consequences. There's a cost. There's a need for forgiveness. And no one actually believed that the blood of the animal covered the sin of a human, but in the law of Moses, it was enough. The challenge was that sacrifices had to be done repeatedly, over and over again. There was no final sacrifice for sin. So with that backdrop in mind, the gravity of John's statement now hits us when he looks at Jesus and he says, "Everyone," as he's pointing to Jesus, "look, It's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Jewish sin, Roman sin, people from Orange County sin, past sin, present sin, future sin, your sin, my sin. It's taken away once and for all. No more sacrifices, no more trying, no more coping mechanisms, no more sin management. Once and for all, you are forgiven. You're covered. On the cross, as Jesus is suffocating to death and he's bleeding out as he's seeing you, being able to actually have you as his own now and forever. Jesus, as you look at the Lamb of God, what he's screaming to us without words is, I've got you covered once and for all. You know, we were out to eat for my birthday a couple years ago, and we were at Vine. Anyone like Vine? So good. Love that spot. Like, best burger in town, I believe. But we ordered up. It was my birthday. And we're like, let's just go big. Got to go big for John Boy's birthday. And John Boy, who's, she never calls me John Boy. That was weird. Sorry about that. So we get appetizers. We get multiple courses. We get desserts. We just order up. And, you know, it's your birthday. Who cares what the bill is going to be at the end? And so we had a great time. We were there for a couple hours, great conversation. And then at the end, the server, she came with the bill, and I put my card out, and she said, you know what? Just as I got the bill, there was someone at the restaurant that said that they wanted to cover you. It's covered. Doesn't that feel so good? Especially when you order up at a restaurant, especially when you go big, especially when your bill is huge, when you go to pay for it and someone says, you know what? I got you covered. I want you to just sit with the gravity of how much the sin that you and I commit over our lifetime, how much that has to hurt God's heart and destroy things in our own lives. And once and for all on the cross, in one sweeping moment, God, through Jesus Christ, says, my child, my son, my daughter, no matter how high your bill is, I got you covered. It's covered. It's covered. It's covered. See, you can live with joy, number one. Why? Because it's covered. Your sins have been taken away. Your sins have been forgiven once and for all. So guess what? You are forgiven and you can forgive yourself. Your guilt and shame is done with. See, other faith systems give you a to-do list. Jesus gives you an it's done list. It's done. It's finished. It's completed. Joy comes in my life personally when the devil tries to remind me of my past. Joy comes when I literally remind him of his future. I say, this is not held against me anymore. This is forgiven. Even if I slip up, I am still a saint. I am a son of God. I am righteous. I am perfect in his eyes. I have the king's blood flowing through my veins. My sin is forgiven, amen? It gives you joy. It gives you joy. You are forever free and forgiven. It's the best deal ever. It's crazy. It's crazy. It's covered. It's covered. Jesus, our Savior. Jesus, he came to give us joy through his forgiveness. The second reason why I can live with joy is the only kind of joy that is true joy, because it's the kind of joy that Jesus offers, is really because I look at Jesus and I want to model the way that he reacted to his circumstances. The first thing is about Jesus' work on the cross. I can live with joy because I'm free, I'm forgiven. The second thing is about the lifestyle of Jesus. Actually learning to live his lifestyle. See, when you think about it, Jesus, he didn't have an easy life. He was born to a poor Jewish family from Nazareth, which was actually like the least significant town in Galilee. There was even a saying back in the day, like, can anything good come from Nazareth? Well, actually, it can. A carpenter who became a savior. But he was a carpenter. That was his occupation. Not an easy job. He had brothers who, like, didn't even believe in him. You don't even hear much about his father, Joseph. Many scholars believe that Joseph may have even died young. And so maybe even Jesus didn't grow up with a dad for much of his life. Jesus, he had Pharisees that were actually his closest spiritual brothers in the faith. You may not realize this because a lot of times in the Gospels, like, Pharisees aren't in the best light and for right purpose. But the Pharisees actually believed theologically the closest thing to Jesus. In a sense, the Pharisees were Jesus' spiritual brothers, and they hated him. They despised him. They tried to throw him off a cliff one time. They wanted to stone him. And in the end, they ended up killing him. Jesus was homeless half the time. One time when he called someone to follow him, someone was super excited and said, Jesus, I want to come with you wherever you go. And he says, that's awesome. Come and follow me, but just be aware. Foxes have holes. Birds have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head, a.k.a. I'm homeless. It's not going to be comfortable. It's not going to be cruisy. It's not going to be easy. If it wasn't people trying to throw him off of a cliff, it was a storm in the middle of the Sea of Galilee trying to kill him. His best friends, the 12 disciples, they didn't really, like, get him most of the time. I want you to think of it. One of his best friends betrayed him to death. And in the end, as he's hanging on the cross, all of his friends bailed on him, deserted him. And then he dies. Then he sacrifices his life for your life and my life. And when we think about the life of Jesus, he could have had every opportunity to live as a victim. He could have had every opportunity to say, you know what, it's not as easy for me as it is for Thomas. You know, Thomas is a realist. Philip, he's a realist. It's not as easy for me as it is for them, but Jesus didn't let his circumstances rob him of joy. See, in the backdrop of everything that I just shared with you that Jesus went through, Jesus was so full of joy that we see little kids like you saw on stage this evening hanging on Jesus' neck all the time. The disciples are like, no, go away. Jesus is super important. Like, he doesn't have time for you. Jesus is like, shut up, guys. Let the kids that are so cute come and hang on me. Jesus was the life of the party. Don't take this the wrong way, but sinners love to hang out with Jesus. Jesus was accused of having too much fun. Jesus was a man that elevated the room. He brought a smile into the atmosphere, joy into the environment. Jesus, think about it. He had so much pressing in on his life, but he walked everywhere. He was never in a hurry. He was at rest. Jesus had the fullest schedule out of any of us, and yet he constantly allowed himself to be interrupted. Jesus had a joy, a satisfaction, a contentment, a peace. But catch this, his life wasn't easy. His life was challenging, it was rigorous, it was stressful at times, it was sacrificial, his life was hard. The God of the universe did not live an easy life, so why do we think we must? Why do we think it would be anything different for us? The second thing that gives me joy when I think about Jesus is this right here. My circumstances are not my thermostat. It's that reality that I want to live with. My circumstances are not my thermostat. Who sets the thermostat at your house? Just shout it out. Does dad do it? Does mom do it? If you're smart, let mom do it. Parents, are your kids messing with it? Right? That AC, come on. Close the door, that AC. What sets the thermostat of your happiness? See, most of the time, what sets the thermostat of our happiness is whether or not things are working out for us, whether things are going good in our life or whether things are going bad in our life. And our joy is predicated on our circumstances. And for many of us, we can become emotionally enslaved to our circumstances. You know, I played in the first inaugural Zion Turkey Bowl flag football competition. Make some noise if you played in that. Anyone? Yes? Where are my boys at? So I had big dreams, big aspirations. I played flag football in college. I was a, you know, really tough guy. In college, I played flag football, and I was like, man, I got like, no joke. I got my receiver gloves. I bought receiver gloves for the Zion flag football competition. I am that guy. It's very embarrassing. Got my cleats on. I got my gloves. I got to the field, and I kid you not, I line up, and the first route that I run, I pull my quad. First route. And I'm like, are you kidding me? Like, you know you're 35 when you pull your quad first route in flag football. And I was like, no, it's just a little tight. Nope, it was like fully blown. Totally done for the day. First route. The entire day. I had so many dreams and aspirations, and oh my gosh, I cannot tell you how bad of a mood I was in the entire day. Like, there wasn't one person at Jim Johnson Sports Park that didn't hear about my quad. Hey, man, I would be out there, you know, but quad, you know, I just blew it, you know, real, you know. I would have caught that, but, you know, the quad. I run a 4.2, but the quad, you know, like, I was doing the quad all day, and I got home, and I tried to talk to husbands. You ever try to talk to your wife about stuff that hurts you? Stuff you're in pain over, and you get zero empathy? I'm like, hey, babe, man, you would not. I was in a horrible mood. I'm like, she's like, how was it? I was like, the quad. I'm 35, babe. You have no idea. And like, she immediately nipped it in the bud. She's like, this is the last I want to hear about it. I don't want to hear about your stupid quad anymore. We're going to have a good night. It's flag football. Get over yourself. And I'm like, okay. All right, honey. Sounds good. But it's crazy how like insignificant things feel really significant to us, and we can become so enslaved in our emotions based on if things are going good or bad in our lives. If we're dating someone or we're single right now, if we got the job or we didn't, if we're in the friendship group that we want to be in or we're not, but then it can get even more serious though. These are like important things in our lives that can really shape our joy or our lack thereof when it comes to how we're doing financially as a family or not, how our business is doing during COVID-19. Trying to have a child and it hasn't happened, or maybe it did happen. And I'm telling you, circumstances don't have to be the indicator of the joy that you can live with on a daily basis. Because being a slave to our circumstance cultivates this victim mentality where everything is someone else's fault. The world is against me. I have it harder than everyone else. When is it finally going to work out for me? Or maybe you're someone and it just feels like it's one thing after another. If it's not the kids, it's the car. If it's not the car, it's the house. If it's not that, it's the kids' school. It's the sports. And it can rob us of joy, these circumstances. Ultimately, this victim mentality can get us to a place where we go, God doesn't care about me. God doesn't love me. Or maybe he doesn't care about me as much as he cares about that other person. And man, I just want to remind you that if God came in the flesh and things didn't always work out for him, if Jesus lived a really hard life, if he experienced sorrow and grief and challenges and obstacles, then what makes us think it'd be anything different for us? It's so crazy how you could have the same thing happen to two different people and see completely different outcomes. It's not about what happens to you in life. It's about how you respond to what happens to you in life. That changes everything. I like this quote by Lena Horne. It says, "It's not the load that breaks you down. It's the way that you carry it." In other words, it's not the circumstances in your life that dictate your joy. It's the way that you respond to your circumstances. Do you allow everything that doesn't work out for you to drag you down? This bottomless pit of depression or disillusionment or doubting God? Or do you say, you know what? Nobody told me it was going to be easy, but this life is worth it. Nobody told me that it was going to be breezy sailing. It was going to be just cruising through life. But God is good. God is faithful. And living for him is worth it. Joy and resilience are interconnected. I've always found that the most joyful people are the most resilient people. And the most resilient people are the most joyful people. There's something about someone that's gone through stuff in life and not allowed it to completely destroy them. It produces so much joy. Joy and resilience. It's not having the easiest life. It's going through hard things and saying, you know what? I'm going to be okay. God is faithful. God is for me. God is on my side. Even if it didn't work out, that's okay, because Nehemiah 8:10 says that the joy of the Lord is my strength. We have to eliminate entitlement from our vocabulary and realize that God doesn't owe me a thing. See, Jesus is the goal. Everything else in life is a gift. You know, we have this amazing opportunity this week. We're going to close on a house here in this area. And it's crazy. And the only reason why I tell you that is because, you know, in our marriage, we've been married for over 6 years. And even before that, I just thought, like, you know, it's totally cool if we just rent here our whole lives, because it's so expensive. There's no way that we're going to get into a house. And God, just in his favor and grace and perfect timing, blessed us with the opportunity to own a home. But you know what? We were talking about it this past week, and Tara and I just said, you know what? It's cool. It's cool that we get to own a home, but we're still renters. You know, we're all renters here on this earth. If you can't take it with you, then it isn't something that you own. And so we're all renters. And so even though we're going to own a house, so to speak, nothing changes about us. Nothing changes about who we are. No, the joy of the Lord is our strength. No matter if we have it or if it's taken from us, God doesn't owe us a thing, but we thank him for the blessing. Jesus is our goal. Everything else is merely a gift. And so what we see is that joyful people are thermostats. They're not thermometers. Joyful people, they set the temperature every single day, and they say, you know what? No matter what happens or comes my way today, or no matter what happens in 2021, we are going to choose joy. See, happiness is a feeling. Joy is a choice. And we're going to choose joy. That's what Jesus did. The third reason why I can live with joy, because of Jesus, really comes down to how Jesus responded to impossible situations. In Mark chapter 5, there's this man named Jairus that comes up to Jesus in the most desperate moment of need. His daughter is critically ill. And he says, Jesus, would you come to my house and heal my daughter? And, you know, Jesus had another person stop him on the way that needed healing. The timeline was off. Jesus was a little slow to get to Jairus' situation. And maybe you've even felt that way. Jesus took longer than what was expected. And then the news comes as Jesus is still in the street. The news comes to Jairus, your daughter is dead. There's no use in troubling the teacher now. Don't bother Jesus. Don't bug him. Just give up. Your daughter just died. But Jesus overheard them and said to Jairus, don't be afraid. Just have faith. Joyful people are not just forgiven people. They're not just thermostats that choose joy in the midst of circumstances that are either great or challenging. Joyful people are faith-filled people. They are people that stare in the face of impossible situations and say, because of Jesus, this situation has to bend its knee at his feet. Jesus, he wasn't a pessimist, a realist, or even an optimist. He was a believer. And Jesus truly believed that nothing is impossible. See, Jesus tells Jairus, don't be afraid, just have faith. And then as Jesus gets to the home, there are all these professional mourners that were, if you can believe it, back in that day, paid. It was a job. It was a contract job to show up to a house where someone had died and you would be paid. You'd be compensated to mourn for the loss of that individual. There were mourners already there. And Jesus shows up and he looks at the mourners and he says, the child isn't dead. She's only asleep. And they all laughed at him. What are you talking about? This was the time where Jesus crossed the line into crazy. And Jesus, he kicks out the doubters. And by the way, maybe that's something for you if you've been struggling with negativity. Maybe you need to distance yourself from some negative voices in your life. Negative influences, pessimistic people, Debbie Downers. I'm sorry, all the Debbies in the world. I know how you got hit with that one. It's unfortunate, but it's interesting that Jesus didn't go, hey, Debbie Downers, come into the room and watch me heal this girl. He said, no, you need to get out. You don't have faith. You don't have belief. I'm looking for people that have faith, that see impossible situations and go, Jesus can do something about that. Jesus then goes up into the room and holding her hand, he said to her, this little girl, Talitha cum, which means little girl, get up. And the girl who was 12 years old, can you imagine this moment? Immediately stood up and walked around. They were overwhelmed and totally amazed. What I see from this passage is oftentimes what we see as dead, Jesus merely sees as asleep. Things in your life that you've given up on, things in your life that you've stopped praying into, things in your life that feel so dried up and dead, Jesus is saying, is it possible that it's only asleep? Is it possible that I am the resurrected one, and I am the only one that can breathe life into that thing again so that you can be filled with my joy? See, Jesus's miracles and healing were not just for the results of the healing. They were also to produce a great joy and amazement within us, seeing how good, loving, and powerful he is. In Acts chapter 8, when Jesus is off the scene, but he sent Holy Spirit to fill us. You have Philip and the other believers around in the city. They're hitting the streets. They're praying for people. Miracles are happening. Healings are happening. And it says in Acts chapter 8 that there was great joy in that city because they saw the healing of Jesus, the deliverance and the freedom of Jesus in the face of impossible situations. Nothing is dead when the resurrected Jesus is involved. When Jesus lived his life, he didn't allow circumstances to write the story. When Jesus saw dead circumstances, guess what he did? He brought healing, he brought hope, and he brought restoration into it. Don't let hopelessness write your story this year. Don't let negativity shape your faith. Don't let impossibility define your theology. See, some large groups of people have actually crafted their theology around the idea that God no longer does the impossible. And something that we believe as a church that we will always carry in our culture is that even if the situation feels dead, hopeless, and impossible, we're going to fight with you. We're going to believe for you because we have a resurrected King who is the professional of the impossible. Nothing is impossible with God. You can live in a state of joy because you have faith that this is not the end. That no matter how dark it looks or bleak it seems, Jesus has the final word. Jeremiah 32:27 says, "I am the Lord, the God of all the peoples of the world. Is anything, anything? Yeah, anything. Is anything too hard for me?" Some of you need to stop telling God how big your mountain is, and you need to start telling your mountain how big your God is. God is so full of power and love, and he's just waiting for you to see that it's merely asleep and not dead. Some of you are here tonight and you have impossible situations in your story. There's been a medical diagnosis that's come your way. There's been a letter from the IRS that just came in the mail. There's been a child that's just walked away from the faith. There's been a relationship that was so near and dear to you that's been severed. And it feels so impossible, but I am here to tell you that Jesus Christ came to reveal to humanity that anything is possible for those who believe. You can see his hand at work and experience the joy of the miracle, the joy of the breakthrough, the joy of God doing what only he can do in your life. No matter how 2021 goes, I've made a resolute declaration in my life. I am going to bring hope into it. I'm going to bring faith into it. I'm going to bring expectation into this new year. I'm not going to allow the news cycle to dictate my 2021 story. I'm not going to allow shutdowns. I'm not going to allow purple tear, magenta, red, yellow. I'm not going to allow the tears to dictate my story. I'm going to bring hope, faith, expectation, love, kindness, peace, joy. Because God elevates me above my circumstances. The last thing that I want you guys to know this evening is, man, this is so important. Because no matter how bad things get in your life, you can live with joy because of this reality that's happening right now in heaven. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 says that for the joy set before him, Jesus endured the cross, scorning its shame. And what's Jesus doing right now? He sat down at the right hand of the throne of God, which means no matter what happens in this life, I know how my story ends. I know how my story ends. In Daniel chapter 3, these three Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, as the whole nation was told, as soon as the music plays, you're to bow down and worship this golden statue. These three Hebrew boys, they didn't bow. They stood for their faith. And they were brought before King Nebuchadnezzar. And in that moment, Nebuchadnezzar, he says, I'm going to give you guys one more chance to bow when the music is played. And if you don't, you're going to be thrown in this fiery furnace and die. He plays the music again and they don't bow. And then their reasoning was this. They said in Daniel 3:18, you know, hey, God can save us. God can do a miracle. God can bring breakthrough and healing. God will deliver us. But even if he doesn't, I love that. Man, may this be an even if kind of year for you. Even if. I love that resolve. I love that faith. Even if he doesn't, I want to make it clear to you, O king, O governing official, I'm going to make something clear to you. Even if I don't get what I want, we will never serve your gods or worship the gold statue that you have set up. Even if God doesn't bring the exact thing that I want or that I'm praying into in this moment, in this timing, I'm not going to bow. I think God is looking for people that have an even if kind of faith. I'm telling you, you're going to experience so much joy in your life when you're not a slave to the outcome. You're not a slave to the experience. You're not a slave to your emotions. When you say, hey, even if this doesn't happen, I'm not going to bow. I'm going to trust God. I'm going to live for him in a culture that's confused. Even if. And the reason why they could say, even if God's still good, we're not going to bow, is because they knew how their story would end. They knew where they would go even if they died. They were confident. They were assured of their home in heaven. They knew where they were going. Believe that God is, he's looking for people that have an even if kind of faith. Even if the healing doesn't come. Even if the breakthrough doesn't happen. Even if the worst case scenario actually plays out, I can live each moment with joy because I know where I'm going. I know that Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. And I don't know if it's today, I don't know if it's 60 years from now, but I get to meet him face to face. There's a crazy confidence and joy that you can live with by knowing where you're going after you die. Man, I don't know how people have gone through 2020 without hope. I don't know how people have gone through 2020 without faith, without an assurance that even if the worst case scenario played out, everything would be all right because you'd get to meet your Savior face to face. See, in our culture, and I'm not preaching against safety at all, but in our culture, what I'm very concerned about it, in our culture, safety and health has become our God. And we absolutely should be wise, and we absolutely should not be foolish, and we absolutely should be safe at whatever degree is possible, but ultimately, safety is not my God. I do not worship health. I courageously have to stand each day and live the life that God has called me to live knowing that at any moment a car could hit me and I could meet my Savior face to face. And guess what? That's not the worst news. It's the best news. I know how my story ends. Even if my health fails, I know that I have a great story. I know where I'm going. I have an assurance of my hope. And I just wonder if you live with that kind of confidence. Because I'm just telling you, man, in this new year, we can have all these new regulations and conditions and ways to do school and not do school and things that will open and close and things with the stock market and things, and I can go down the list, but I'm telling you, if you attach yourself to the rise and fall of everything that's going to happen this year, you will not live with joy. But if you know how your story ends and you go, you know what, even if you will live with a resounding joy, a peace, a confidence, and you are the light of the world. In a world of confusion, darkness, and hopelessness, guess what you get to bring? You get to bring joy. That's who we are. It's a joy that Jesus only offers. You can't get it anywhere else. It's not a temporary feeling of happiness. It's a resounding experience of joy. Would you pray with me all across this place, heads bowed and eyes closed? Jesus is going to carry you through it. I just want you to hear that. No matter what you're facing right now in this season of life that you're in, Jesus is with you. Jesus can elevate you above your circumstance. You don't have to be a slave to the moment. You can have faith, a resolve, a courage, and a confidence in a God who came for you and stopped at nothing to have you. And He wants to fill you with His joy. And so, Jesus, we ask that you would come and fill us this evening with your Spirit's joy that only you can offer. Lord, I pray that you would take the cobwebs of our life and just clean them out right now and fill us with a fresh infilling of your joy. Give us like a bounce in our step from this night on as we go into our holiday season and we hang out with our family and our in-laws, and there's conversations about COVID-19 and conversations about politics. May we be light in dark places. May we be sources of joy, faith-filled people, full of expectation, brimming with hope. The best is yet to come, Jesus, because you are in it. I declare right now that 2020 is not a lost year. It's a year of good news. It's a year that you have been at work. It's a year that you've been stripping the church away from things that we don't need and setting us on fire for you again. So we praise you for your joy. No matter what season of life we're in, you are worthy to be praised. You are working in the midst of it. And so we worship you.
Like the frost on a rose, winter comes for us all. Oh, our nature acquaintance with the nature of patience.
I can see this now. I've been buried to grow, for your promise is loyal, from sea to sequoia. Yeah, I know, though the winter is long, even richer, the harvest it brings. And though the waiting is long, even greater, your promise for me like the sea. I believe that my season will come. Seasons, and I'm just in the winter. If all I know of harvest, if that is worth my patience, and if you're not done working, God, I'm not done waiting. You can see my promise. Turn graves into gardens.
You're the Come on, we're gonna sing that again. You turn craze. You turn craze into God. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the
guys to know, before we leave, we have a ministry team over here at the prayer tent. If you need prayer for anything in your lives, we would love to partner with you, especially if you feel like the joy is gone and you need to add the joy of Jesus to your journey. If there's anything going on in your life that you're struggling with, that you're mourning over, that you're constantly finding yourself falling into, or just anything in life, sickness of body, mind, a lost child that you've been praying to come home, man, we would love to partner with you and just invoke the kingdom of heaven to come on your behalf. We mean it. We believe that prayer changes everything, amen? And so we want to pray with you. Don't rush out if you don't have to. We're going to end with some worship, and we're going to have an opportunity to pray. I want to commission you guys to be beacons of light this week, fueled with the joy of Jesus. Would you just get the joy of Jesus over everybody that you come across this week? Would you receive that? Can you just put your hands out and just receive this prayer? I just want to pray over you. God, I'm reminded by that song, and may it never grow old, that You are the same God who split seas, the same God who shut the mouths of lions, the same God who, with a little slingshot, took down Goliath with one pebble. You are the same God who opened the eyes of the blind, who allowed the deaf to hear. You are the same God who raised Lazarus, who was dead for 4 days, back to life. You are the same God who died and 3 days later came back to life. You are for us. You are with us. And nothing is too hard for you. Nothing is too hard. Nothing is impossible. And so I bless you, church, with the joy of Jesus Christ. May God show up at your workplace. May God show up on your Zoom call. May God show up in your house in the morning as you turn on Maverick City and worship Him. May God show up in the mundane, boring spaces. May God show up in the coffee shops. May joy be your story this week. The culture may be confused. The media may be spewing fear, but we are different. We are people of joy. We are carriers of hope. We are the light of the world. And so I bless you with the light, the love, and the hope of Jesus this week. And if you receive it and believe it, say amen. Give God a shout of praise. Amen. Amen.
You turn graves into God.
still bless you. And I still bless you. And I still bless you. And I still bless you.
Still bless you. been so, so good to me.
Your shadow, you won't light up. Mountain, you won't climb up.
you guys next week. Merry Christmas. 4 o'clock next week, okay? 4 o'clock, all right? Have a good night, everyone. Say good night. Say night night.
Great job, you guys.
Yeah, oh my God.